Drama contains adult language and partial nudity. Viewer discretion is advised.
It may look like New York City, but it's actually the back lot of Fox Studios in Los Angeles, where many of the exterior scenes of NYPD Blue are shot.
Yeah, copy that. You got 50 squad in the scene here.
Today, it's been transformed into a party.
Say it, buddy.
The alumni of NYPD Blue are here to celebrate the start of the 10th season of the show. It's a rare milestone in a TV landscape where most shows don't make it past the second season. The interior set of the 15th Precinct is quiet tonight, but over the last 10 years, this set has seen its share of drama.
That caught me by surprise. I should have never let her be part of this.
Didn't figure we'd come up with Trish, didn't think we'd tear down this phantom Puerto Rican number two, which took us about 27 minutes, you murdering scumbag nitwit!
Will someone shut him up?
I'm all right.
I'm Joe Mantegna. In 1993, ABC took a risk on a show called NYPD Blue. The language was raw, the violence was palpable, and the reactions were polarized. While the religious right was outraged, there were others who saw it as a needed dose of reality in a TV world that had grown out of touch with the chaos of America's big city streets.
NYPD Blue.
NYPD Blue.
82 Emmy nominations later, NYPD Blue is considered one of the most successful television shows in history. But some of the most dramatic conflicts of NYPD Blue never appeared in any episodes. They were the real-life dramas that happened behind the scenes.
The whole experience for me was a big roller coaster ride.
There was this total backlash from the press.
It was a volatile time.
We just never had a normal year.
We knew that the work that we were doing was great. How we got to it was not always a cakewalk.
For the next hour, you'll hear the true story of NYPD Blue, the highs and the lows, from the people that lived it. And join the crew on the streets of New York City, a changed New York City, as they begin shooting season 10. When we come back, inside NYPD Blue, a decade on the job. New York City. The NYPD Blue cast and crew are on the streets to shoot exteriors for the show.
Hey! Hey, police! Freeze!
Here we go.
Turn down that shit, man.
Cut.
Ready.
It's almost 100 degrees today as the crew sets up a complicated shot.
Okay, lock it up, please. First team rehearsal.
I want to get one guy down here. Can we pan over?
Executive producer Mark Tinker is directing the scene using an intercom system that allows him to communicate with his cameraman.
A little crisper on the moves.
The show's trademark visual style doesn't come easy.
Snap. Stay there for a beat. Go to Dennis. Back to Mark Paul. Not only can they hear the dialogue that the actors are saying, they can. I can talk to them, and I'll tell them, you know, go down and see the hand. Go and find someone so-and-so coming through the door. You know, make sure that you don't, you know, miss being on someone's face at such and such a time. I'm constantly talking to them, in addition to telling them bad jokes.
Stop, police! Hey, don't move! Don't move!
Why are you running?
Because you're chasing me. You got the wrong guy, man.
Handcuff.
Handcuff!
God, you guys are joking.
If it seems these guys are having just a bit too much fun, it's probably because they are. 10 years of history will do that. But things were not always so smooth for NYPD Blue.
When we first were introduced to Andy Sipowicz, we're meeting a man here, basically a very good, strong man, who probably was a good father, a good husband, good cop, but he started some kind of downhill slide that he could not put the brakes on.
Make sure he gets home. He's a cop.
And by rights, he should have died in the first time. I was shot like 5 or 6 times.
I'm not counting you out.
That's been part of the interest in Sipwoods. You root for an underdog.
In the beginning, the show itself was an underdog. NYPD Blue was conceived by Stephen Bochco and David Milch in the early 90s. Bochco, who had created the groundbreaking Hill Street Blues, and Milch, who had won Emmys writing it, were up against the wall. The one-hour television drama was dying. Network viewers were heading to cable TV in droves, lured by less restricted fare at the push of a remote control button. Bochco felt it was time to push some buttons of his own.
The vision was just to do a contemporary cop show that was reflective in a very realistic way of New York City and on a larger scale, America. The bells and whistles were the language and the sexuality.
He wanted to do a cop show that broke new ground in terms of its candor, both verbal and visual. And it was a long fight.
We were under staggering assault, you know, from all kinds of quarters, most intensely from the religious right. And this Reverend Wildman had taken out full page ads in every major newspaper in America, accusing us of the most incredible and totally erroneous things.
Advertisers were nervous, and 20% of the ABC affiliates said they wouldn't run the pilot. After long negotiations, Bochco and the network came to a compromise. Each episode would be closely inspected to make sure nothing, well, slipped through the cracks.
There was so much of a breast you could see, or so much of a backside you could see, and, you know, you would inspect the film frame by frame in editorial, and then ABC censors would see things.
A glossary of acceptable profanities was drafted along with a number of times they could be said. 37.
Do not ask me how we got to that number. I can't remember how we got to that number, but that was the number.
On September 21st, 1993, the pilot of NYPD Blue aired, and America got its first look at Andy Sipowicz. He didn't hold back.
When we first began the show 9 years ago, the face of television was much more tame than it is now. At that time, I'm represented by this assistant district attorney, played by Sharon Lawrence.
Hey, Miss District Attorney, you really prosecuted the crap out of that one.
I went with the crap I had, Detective.
As we're walking down the steps, she says ipso something or other to me, and I said, well,
ipso this, you pissy little bitch.
I was so happy to be able to say those words. It was just such a great opportunity for an actor to be able to say those words on television. You don't get to do that.
But clearly, there was much more to NYPD Blue than bad words and bare behinds. It just felt real, and there was a reason for that. In the year that it took to get the show on the air, co-creator and head writer David Milch had flown to New York and done a bit of detective work of his own. There, he discovered a valuable ally, homicide detective Bill Clark. The Hollywood writer and the Brooklyn detective developed an unlikely but deep friendship and spent hours together driving the streets of New York City.
You've heard the expression, God is in the details, and I got to live into the details. I came to an entirely different understanding of what it meant to be a cop.
Clark was hired by the show as a consultant. Half the week, he solved murders in New York, and the other half, he worked on the Los Angeles set. While he was paid to make sure the actors knew how to hold their gun right, in reality, he was there to tell true stories to David Milch. Soon, Clark's cases, experiences, and even his personality began to seep into the storylines of NYPD Blue.
I used to always want the confession. I would keep pressing. Why? How come? How many more did you do? You know.
I have enough right now to lock you up. Your blood was all over the place, and nowadays, blood is like a fingerprint.
Watching Bill do an interview with a suspect,
he would choreograph it in a particular way. He would play a particular role that he felt would ultimately bring the other character to reveal his or her deepest nature. That's what a storyteller is supposed to do.
I'll be back.
The difference is, you know, when we're done, we say cut, and when Bill's done, he says, you got to write to an attorney.
Bill Kolak was certainly one of the top detectives in the department. He's the real deal, a genuine article, and he took that drive. He has tremendous determination. Anybody that knows him knows that he's going to deliver, gets the job done. That's the way he was as a cop, and that's the way he is now.
The thing that powers him is understanding of human nature. And as you dig deeper and as he talks more and more about it, you find out the extent of personal responsibility he feels to each victim that he's dealt with.
Today, 10 years after he was first hired, Clark, now an executive producer of the show, drives the streets of Brooklyn and recalls one of his many cases which inspired episodes of NYPD Blue.
I had a case down Weirfield Street here.
What do we got? It's like sexual assault, strangulation.
Oh, God, I knew it. I knew it.
I had to tell the parents that their son, we just found his body and that he had been killed. And I got to also tell them that I had the guy who had done it. The day of the funeral, I think I was getting ready to go to the grand jury. And I spoke outside of the house to the mother and the father.
At the top of the building, do you see that?
There was a white pigeon up on the roof. That pigeon gave them a sense that their son was in heaven now.
Do you see a light from it?
I think there is a light there coming out of him.
I'm a pigeon flyer from Brooklyn. I've pigeons my whole life. There was no valid reason, no reason in the world why that white pigeon should have been sitting on that roof. And when I saw a story that I had worked, you know, 10 years later, told that way and with the emotional impact on everybody involved, I was proud that I was part of this whole business, you know.
The show's creators were also intrigued with the lingo of the job and began working it into scripts. In the hands of a writer like Milch, this rough slang started to sound like poetry.
You Murphy, a guy, we're not looking to jam you for that.
Guy, lawyer it up.
Who's the scout?
Andy don't piss off a perp and walk out with his hand on his Johnson.
He'd use words that I didn't get.
Luds and muds on a crime scene phone.
It would almost be like, how can I challenge Dennis Moore?
Yeah, you keep talking like we're chums, Blimpy. We'll give you the secret handshake at the station house.
One episode, we wanted to use the word where I was talking about a woman's fatigus. And then the network came to us and they said,
we're making an official request to talk to you, detective.
You can't say fatigus on the air. David says, why not? You can't say fatigus. That's unacceptable. David says, I made up the word. I made it up. It doesn't mean... He says, it's... Well, you can't say it. I don't care. Coming out of Sipowicz's mouth, it sounds filthy. So, I mean, David pressed those kind of buttons continuously. He went after that.
When we return, Bochco's gamble pays off big. But there's trouble in the 15th when Hollywood battles seep into the gritty world of New York.
Things at 11.
Washington Square Park in Manhattan. NYPD Blue fans gather to watch the film.
Background.
Hold on, sir.
What?
Hey! Police, freeze! Cut!
The average age of the onlookers is noticeably younger now, due in no small part to Mark Paul Gosselaar, the actor who went from Saved by the Bell to the 15th Precinct without looking back.
Action!
A year ago, Gosselaar was put through the paces on his first day on the job.
Basically, my first day was like, you know, here's your shoes, start running.
Okay, let's take one more pass at this.
Can't we?
The whole day was just, you know, watch the new guy run. My God, he can run.
Don't stop.
Run again right away.
But now Gosselaar settled comfortably into his role as John Clark, Andy Sipowicz's newest partner.
So you intend to stay at least a year?
If there's one thing that never changes on NYPD Blue, it's that everything changes.
You want to spend your time harassing a starving artist like me? Go right ahead.
Get used to that starving part.
In the second season of the show, it looked like the storm of protest had passed. The show was a smash hit, earning high ratings and a record 27 Emmy nominations. David Caruso's portrayal of Detective John Kelly made him the hottest thing on television.
Come here, Norman. Okay, I'm getting sick of you. Tell me if this is unloaded or not.
I don't know!
You're right. Empty.
Even the infamous butt shots were now so acceptable that Dennis Franz got in on the act.
During that first season, we were shooting on the streets. People would pass by and say, "Yo, Sipowicz, when are we going to see your ass?" So we thought, you know, let's accommodate these people. Let's give it to them. So we had this shower scene.
For me, the most prominent element about the whole thing is that nobody even remembers that I was naked.
What are you doing?
They were all up in arms about Dennis's ass right there on the screen.
Whoa.
NYPD Blue.
NYPD Blue.
NYPD Blue. Wow.
It should have been the best of times, but it wasn't. Despite all the success, the NYPD Blue set was racked with tension. Caruso, an intense, opinionated actor, was unhappy with the direction of his character and wanted out. In the book True Blue, David Milch says the on-set clashes were threatening to destroy the show.
It got rough on the set. I can remember, you know, a moment where David said, "Who writes this script?" That was a little difficult for me. We knew that the work that we were doing was great. How we got to it was not always a cakewalk.
The show had such promise and such excitement behind it, and yet there was this real issue.
The tension hit Milch the hardest. He was in charge of keeping Caruso happy. One day, in the midst of yet another on-set blow-up, Milch suffered a mild heart attack. He recovered, but Stephen Bochco had had enough.
You know, David Milch is too ill. You know, he's going to wind up on his knees in the parking lot if we don't get rid of this guy. He's unhappy. He don't want to be here.
Caruso was let out of his contract. To this day, reactions to his unexpected departure are varied.
Listen, James.
Yeah.
I'm leaving the job.
You know, we had a connection, me and him. And, you know, and he was a wild guy. I will not deny that he wasn't wild. He was wild. But he, for me, he was, I found him to be very exciting to work with because, you know, he came in ready to score 40 points. Don't quit, John.
Listen, James, you're going to be okay. Just keep doing what we talk about.
He was just too damn critical on himself because, you know, when you're doing that kind of good work, you should enjoy it a little more.
He was an interesting guy. He was a great character. He walked out the back door of that stage, never said goodbye to anybody, and left.
Co-creator Stephen Bochco was now faced with a serious problem. How to replace one of the most popular actors on television at the height of his fame.
I remember calling ABC after surviving that first year. Now you call and you say, you know, we're letting go the hottest new guy in television.
The knee-jerk reaction by everyone was, things running so smoothly, I wonder if it's going to be able to continue to work without him.
Into this atmosphere of uncertainty walked Bobby Simone, played by Jimmy Smits. His entrance into the 15th precinct was carefully orchestrated by the show's creators.
Along comes this guy, Bobby Simone.
Morning.
And Sipowicz was not going to have anything to do with the new partner. I'm resigned that I'm not going to give it up to him.
Andy Sipowicz. Oh, Andy, Bobby Simone, good to meet you.
Yeah. The first scene we did, you know, when Simone comes in and he just shakes hands with Dennis and he goes out and he finds Fancy, so this isn't going to work.
Yeah, that's not going to work out.
What happened?
Oh, don't get me started. I mean, his attitude's all wrong.
How you doing, this kind of thing? NG.
How you doing, this type of thing?
He asked you how you were doing?
Yeah.
Sipowicz was able to express the audience's resistance in such an extreme way that the audience wound up saying, hey, give the guy a chance.
The writing trick worked, and Simone was accepted by audiences and by the precinct.
I want to ask this guy to stand up for me. We've become pretty friendly. I think he's a good guy.
Yeah.
The cast change energized the show. During the Smiths era, NYPD Blue became much more than just a cop show. Characters developed lives outside of the 15th. The Sipowicz-Simone partnership was the spine of the show, but now America also got to know Medavoy.
I mean, gifted.
Martinez.
Wow.
And of course, Donna Abbandando.
Do you like hockey?
I'm not a huge fan.
Donna Abbandando, the one Greg was involved with. Donna's sweetness and Medavoy's bumbling and his nervousness were just this escape from the precinct and everything going on, and it just worked.
Save me, Gregory. All right, let's get out of here. Take her to
book. I gotta go to a pet shop.
I think my favorite moment in 10 years was when Gail O'Grady and Deborah Messing were fighting over me.
I'm very attracted to you. I'm all yours, detective.
Oh, boy.
That's some kind of heaven. I don't know.
As the audience became hooked into each one of the characters and what kind of, like, what their buttons were all about. I mean, there's somebody's pushing that Sipowicz button right there. You know what's going to happen with him.
I think you're an asshole.
I think you're an asshole.
What's wrong with this country?
What's wrong with this country? What's wrong with it is too many people from other countries screw it up.
There was also the love affair between Simone and Diane Russell, an on-screen romance that scooped up a whole new female audience and won Kim Delaney an Emmy.
Something happened, Bobby. I was only 12. I didn't know that would happen.
You're gonna be all right. Each one of these characters has a kind of ghost that they walk with, whether it's having to be sober and what that means, if you've been affected by domestic violence, if you've experienced a loss in your life.
Take care of the baby.
Each of them kind of walks with something. It's those kind of character tags that affect the way they deal with their day-to-day job. That's what engages the audience.
I've been a lousy father, Andy.
You threw a damn grenade into my life. Is that the best you could come up with? I hate you, Dad.
When we return, NYPD Blue
season premieres that will leave you breathless. Sunday starting at 9, 8 Central on ABC.
What's this?
That's the family whose case we're working.
You pat him down for box cutters?
Hey, come on.
You figure they'd give him their own hospital till this blows over.
Yeah, what, they're on drinking fountains too?
All right, I withdraw the comment.
In many ways, Detective Andy Sipowicz is one of the most complicated TV characters ever created. While it's easy to think of him merely as an Archie Bunker with a badge, the truth is not so black and white. Americans of all races do seem to love Sipowicz, almost despite themselves. It's most obvious on the streets of New York City, as Dennis Franz is treated like a hometown hero. Much of the popularity of Sipowicz is due to Franz's ability to find the basic decency in a very flawed character. The reality is that Franz couldn't be more different from Sipowicz. For the other actors on the show, it's almost eerie to witness the transformation.
He comes on the set, he's happy, he's just really generous as an actor, and just really sweet. And as soon as they say rolling or action, it's like he's become this other person, and you're a little intimidated, let me tell you.
You're dealing with that one nigga in a thousand who knows what you can and cannot do.
I'm dealing with a nigger whose big mouth is responsible for this massacre.
Andy. You back off!
You're a racist detective. Do you use the word nigger?
Back off!
Kiss my ass, you smart mouth little punk.
One of the things that I learned through working with Dennis is that because of who he is, he was allowed to be all these things and still be every man.
Why don't the two of us get together after work?
No ranks?
No ranks. Just folks.
Why wait?
After work.
One of my favorite ongoing relationships was the relationship
with Lieutenant Fancy on the show.
This isn't about a word, Andy, or your impure thoughts. It's about you making this case harder to work.
Not about you being black, huh? Not about giving some back to me?
It's about what I say it's about.
Then say, part of what it's about is watching me sweat.
Dennis and I were so cool with each other that we could talk about it in the makeup trailer. And it was kind of like giggle time that we were allowed to get into this territory on national network television, you know.
I'm not going to take you out, Andy. I move you out, my white bosses, they send me a little message. They send me another one just like you. But maybe that one can't do the job like you can.
Jeez, thanks a lot, boss.
One of my favorite episodes was Fancy trying to make Sipowicz be more understanding and less of a bigot. He took me to a rib joint, and we had dinner. And I was the only white guy. And he said, how does it feel? Enjoy your ribs.
So why would you feel uncomfortable? Is it the atmosphere, Andy?
Well, that's possible.
What difference does it make what they're thinking? That they don't like you? Hey, that's just an opinion. Why should that bother you? Now, what if they had guns and badges?
Sipowicz is like this marine crustacean, you know, that you're amazed he can move from one place, you know, to the other. He's got so many barnacles and other growths on him. And yet he's always somehow able, you know, to reach out. And then you see that even a marine crustacean could be a beautiful creature of God.
This is handy stuff.
This belongs to my son.
The scene that sticks out most in my mind involved Dennis Franz when he finds his dead son in the hospital.
Somebody killed him.
Dennis played it so that it was like the wind had been sucked out of his lungs.
What many people don't know about the character of Andy Sipowicz is how personal he is to the show's co-creator, David Milch. For the first 7 seasons of the show, the Emmy-winning writer poured out his personal demons into the character of Sipowicz. Milch has always been open about his battles with alcohol and heroin, but it was his willingness to explore his demons through his characters that has led many who know him to call him a genius.
I have a few drinks, trying to deal with things. I walk till I'm sober. I make sure I'm sober coming home.
You are not sober when you come home.
I'm sober at home, at work. I meet my responsibilities.
You're not meeting your responsibilities.
Sipowicz is an addict. He's an alcoholic. I'm an alcoholic, among other things.
Let's just say Sipowicz got sober before I did. He was almost a beacon of hope for me. I was able to enact that daily struggle in Sipowicz.
Do you want people to help you, Andy?
Please help me.
I'm not sure that I would have lived long enough to have come to the blessing of individual sobriety if I hadn't had that process available to me as a kind of example. So in that sense, Sipowicz is a very deep personal gift.
But for the people on the show, there was a flip side to the brilliance of the writing, and that was the day-to-day reality of working with David Milch. By taking on so much of the burden of creating the world of NYPD Blue, including writing, producing, directing, even editing, Milch was slowly running himself into the ground. More and more, he was delivering his script so late to the actors that they had no time to prepare. Jimmy Smits now says that it was this kind of last-minute writing that led to his leaving the show. As much as he loved working on NYPD Blue, acting scenes that had been handed to him moments before the camera rolled was agony.
What started out as being a very kind of exciting experience to me became very frustrating for me as an actor.
Detective Simone, that's with Anith, shield number 3118.
I am not a quick study. There are a lot of people on that set that were, you know, very adept at memorizing lines really quickly and turning the stuff over, but I don't work like that. I'm not trying to say anything negative, but that's the real deal in terms of what happened with me and why I moved on.
Smith's departure led to one of the show's most unforgettable storylines, the death of Bobby Simone.
I never thought I'd make a new friend. Now he's gonna die.
No, you don't know that Bobby is gonna die.
He told me in his eyes.
I think that those episodes really explored what loss is, what grief is.
I'll take care of her.
What contemplating one's life is all about. And as an actor, what you want to be able to do is, you know, touch the audience that's watching. Whether it be, you know, make them laugh, make them cry, make them think. And on that set, we got to do all of that.
It very quickly didn't become a story about losing a character. It became a story about faith, life, fear, courage, you know, and God.
The image in his own mind of all those friends on the rooftop, you know. Now, I must have seen that thing 30 times and lost it every time.
With Smith's off the show, it looked like NYPD Blue might also be on its deathbed. When Bochco announced it was former child star Rick Schroeder that would replace Smith's, the critics were harsh.
Squad's upstairs?
Yeah, what do you need?
I'm assigned up there.
So that's what 14-year-olds are wearing now?
Yeah, me and all my pals.
There was this, you know, total backlash from the press, and it shocked me. A lot of the press were like, what? You're hiring Rick Schroeder for NYPD Blue and to replace Jimmy Smith's? It was like scoffing at me, and it hurt.
You know, people were not necessarily ready to give him a lot of credit at the beginning, and he proved everybody wrong.
Are you afraid of being struck at all or beaten during this interview?
Obviously, yes.
Don't say again you tried to be his friend.
When we return, new
secrets for survival. Plus, put down the Joe and pick up the tea. Why your heart will thank you on Eyewitness News at 11.
With a tough new partner for Andy Sipowicz, season 7 saw NYPD Blue dodging another bullet. Schroeder stepped up and ratings stayed high. But the young actor found himself in a world where the normal rules of television production had been thrown out the window. Because David Milch's connection with Andy Sipowicz was so personal, he was convinced nobody else could create the scenes. As his battle with substance abuse got worse, so did his ability to collaborate.
What you see in any dysfunctional organism is that the organism adapts, you know, to the illness of one of its members. And so everybody began to try to, does anyone know who the characters are in the show this week?
Where in seasons past, scripts came late, now they often didn't come at all. Instead, Milch would come to the set and simply make it up on the spot.
Hey, Baldwin. Let's not have any direct or simple communications. Don't say nothing to me I don't have to work on with a decoder ring.
People were writing inside their eyelids and on the bottoms of their shoes, you know.
I don't even know why I'm hiding in here.
If you ever done a school play, we're doing a school play. Except when we got to the theater, we didn't know what the play was.
We no longer had scripts. We would come in, and David would sit us down, and we'd kind of talk it out. He would say, it'll be great. You say this, and he'll say this. And then we'd say, nah, let me see that. So then you do it, and he'd say, nah, let's forget that. Let's do something. I said, all right, you come in. And then he said, is Medivoy, we got Gordon here? Is Gordon here?
Actors wore beepers at all times in case they were needed.
Coast is clear. Where are we going?
And it was like being a doctor on call for 24 hours a day. You never knew what, you didn't know what you were going to say, where you're going to be. But it was, wow, what a way to work.
David comes up with this monologue about an ostrich running around in a circus with a guy whipping him in a circus.
Nobody is looking to make you the main performer.
I ain't in your circus no kind of way.
It was like that long. It was all words. It was all just random thoughts.
I was the ringmaster and snapping the whip and, you know, and the collection of words together, the images that they set up were fascinating. It was like watching a modern art, a piece of modern art, but not quite getting it.
And then he gives it to Dennis.
And we're rolling.
You're not the circus, huh, pal? Well, don't ever find yourself by mistake in a herd of earring-wearing ostriches, because the next thing you know, you are going to be right with the rest of the flock, sprinting around, double time on the outside edge of the center ring, ducking your heads while that psycho with the top hat cracks his whip a half inch from your nose.
As difficult as the environment was that season, you know, we did some amazing, amazing work. But I did know that I couldn't function any longer.
It was just a lot of weight on him.
I had told Stephen before the beginning of the seventh year that it would be my last year.
At the end of season seven, David Milch left the show to pursue other projects and take a much-needed rest. Critics, once again, wrote off the show as incapable of surviving.
John, notify the Emmy's office. I want them down there again.
Once again, critics were wrong.
It ain't going nowhere. As long as that heart and soul that, you know, Sipowicz's character really, you know, embodies is there.
Squad sticks together. We're a team. You're on the team.
The world of the real NYPD has changed dramatically since the show was created. But through it all, New York cops still seem to love NYPD Blue. To them, Andy Sipowicz remains a symbol of what it means to be on the job.
Police officers really like the show.
It means a lot to New York. Certainly, post September 11th, it means a lot. This city has bounced back tremendously, but we took a terrific blow.
Here just before 9/11 last year, about a month before, I think somehow it did maybe hit us a little harder because of our connection here, because of the fact that we've known so many cops here.
In fact, I have a picture taken from a rooftop over near Astor Place. We shot that street last year, and down at the other end, the two towers, and now it's not there. You go there and you stand there and you look at what is missing, and It starts all over.
The effects of 9/11 have brought certainly more respect of police officers in general around the world. And nowhere is it more heartfelt than in New York City for police officers and firefighters.
Reminders of what happened are never far away. A block away from the filming, a real fire engine is on a routine call. The engine was one of the few that made it out on 9/11.
Like all these nicks and dings here? That's from the World Trade Center, all these. The windows were gone, the lights, everything. It was all gone.
What they do is much more important than what we do. What we do is really insignificant. They're the real heroes. They're the people that should be idolized. They're the people that kids should look up to.
As an actor, I always want to make the people that I'm embodying proud, and I only feel that much more now that 9/11 has happened. We just really want to do a good job and make law enforcement, particularly NYPD, really proud if we can.
Two real detectives from the 75.
Hi, I'm Tommy
Charlotte.
Welling.
Nice to meet you.
Hi. You can't come here without acknowledging what has taken place, you know, but it is still New York City, and it is the greatest spot in the world, and the heart and the spirit and the life is still here.
We're in New York. You get knocked around, you know, they come back.
When we return, some final words from Dennis Franz.
Fighting deadly disease with green tea. Surprising news at 11.
For the last hour, we've taken a look at the history of NYPD Blue. A history filled with the kinds of ups and downs that would ruin most shows. It's the story of a risk-taking television creator, a talented writer, and a cop. It's also the story of one of the most unlikely leading men on television.
Luckiest man of the year. What's that all about?
Did you see that coming?
When you get a chance, I want to go over some flights to Orlando.
Go away, Andy.
My man.
You're my hero.
Yeah, check you out, talking like a player.
And watch it.
You know, we've got another Beauty and the Beast syndrome going here.
It's just Theo wants you to go, so.
Do you want me to go?
To Disney World? I haven't even thought about it.
Another wonderful highlight, the relationship that I've had with Theo over the last few years. Now, Theo is becoming a small human being who can walk and talk, and now that we can have storyline and interaction, it's great. The little Austin Majors, he's wonderful.
If she doesn't come, I won't go.
Then we won't go?
Fine.
You want to go?
If I was asked.
Well, we definitely have separate rooms. It's not like we'd be going away together.
I'd love to go. When?
Between Austin and Charlotte Ross, Sipowicz is in a pretty good spot.
Drop it! Get an ambulance over here!
Stephen Boschko and David Milch called me 9 years ago to say that they were developing a new cop show. I really wasn't interested in getting involved. At that point, I had played 27 cops, and I was reluctant for cop number 28.
Come here, listen to me now. You know, everybody's life has twists and tensions. So don't you assume that you know all the answers, all right? Don't assume that you ever will.
I'm ever thankful that I had the common sense to hang in there for that cop number 28.
This is a good job for people like us. Don't ever embarrass this job.
I won't.
I know you won't.
Up next,